My name is Dr. Jennifer Haley Brown, and today I'm going to discuss how to write successful chemistry lab reports. We'll start by talking about planning your lab report. Then we will go over discussion section strategies. Next, we'll talk about improving your word choice and your tone. And finally, I offer a one-time read-through checklist that you can use as a reference when you are doing a final proofread before you turn in your lab report. If your instructor gives you a lab report guide, you should always go with what your class guide says if anything there conflicts with what I'm saying today. In general, though, your report will include a pre-lab report, which includes tables, the protocol, and any pre-lab calculations. Also, you must include a data collection section, which sets forth the data you collected and any interesting observations you made during the experiment. Your data processing section will include all of the equations, calculations, and labeled graphs explaining the data you collected. We won't discuss any of that any further today. Instead, we will focus on the discussion section of your lab reports. Anytime you begin a writing task, you should take a moment to consider your audience and why you are writing at all, other, of course, than the fact that you have to write a report to earn your grade. I think that it's helpful to imagine your lab report as having two separate audiences. Most of the sections, from the pre-lab report through the data processing section, should be written for a very broad audience. Any person who has a basic understanding of how to do chemistry experiments and who wants to exactly repeat the steps that you took. Your goal in these sections is to explain your process as simply as possible, including specific numbers where relevant. All chemists who write articles about their research include very similar accounts of their own experiments, and they know that other chemists won't simply take their word that they got a certain result. Instead, they write with a goal of allowing other chemists to duplicate their work, which can prove that the results of their experiment were not a fluke, but are reliable. In your report, you also have this goal. You want to record your process in a way that could be duplicated again and again by many people. That's why you must write these sections specifically, clearly, and for a broad general audience. For the discussion section, on the other hand, you should write with your instructor as your primary audience. In other words, the purpose of this section is to prove to your instructor that you did the work and to tell a larger story about how this experiment fits into the course as a whole. The very best discussion sections will also show your instructor that you're thinking well beyond the course and considering how what you're learning here applies to the world outside of class. The overall goal of your discussion section is for you to present your data, to convince the reader that the data is reliable, and importantly, to give evidence for that argument. Like every paragraph in your discussion section, your introduction should open with a topic sentence that highlights the major point the paragraph will make. For example, your introduction paragraph to an electrochemistry lab report might begin something like, "This lab used a homemade potato battery to demonstrate the flow of electrons in a galvanic cell." The major goal of this paragraph is to say what you did in the experiment and why you did the things that you did. You should also define all of the special or necessary terms that you will use throughout your report, such as galvanic cell or cathode. If you feel stumped, try reading through the existing knowledge questions in the lab guide to get an idea of what kinds of questions you might want or need to answer. Remember that you should have at least three body paragraphs in your discussion section. Your goal is to explain how your experiment results prove or demonstrate the scientific concepts the lab explores. In other words, you'll take your data and your observations from the experiment, and then you'll explain how they support or how they don't support the major theories or concepts that you're studying in class. If you feel stuck here, you can look to the analysis questions in your lab guide and work from there. Now let's talk about how to prove your claims by using your data effectively. Anytime that you make a claim in one of your body paragraphs, you must support that claim with specific numbers and/or calculations. For example, you do not want to say the ice melted slowly. That is too vague and too imprecise for a chemistry lab report. Instead, you should say, The ice melted in 4.2 minutes. Here's another example. You don't want to say the reaction was warm. Again, it's too vague, it's too imprecise. Instead, try the reaction was exothermic. This was shown when the temperature was measured initially at 25.0 degrees Celsius and it increased to 93.0 degrees Celsius. In every body paragraph, you must prove what you're saying by using similar data and calculations from your own experiment to support your argument. You may also include a body paragraph on the assumptions that you made during the experiment. What did you assume or take for granted? For example, I might assume that the potato I used to make the battery was not rotten on the inside, where I couldn't see it when I began my experiment. Listing the assumptions you made can reveal the limits of an experiment. For example, a potato probably conducts electricity differently if it is rotten than if it is freshly harvested. You can look to the assumptions question in your lab guide to get your ideas flowing for this one. Let's talk about identifying failure in your lab reports. It happens. If something goes haywire during your lab and the data does not support the theories, you can also discuss why that might have happened. First, you should identify what went wrong. For example, maybe the results do not support the theories the lab was designed to teach. Then, you might speculate why the problem happened. For example, maybe you spilled while you were measuring a fluid, or maybe you learned you didn't measure as precisely as you should have. Important scientific work almost always includes a discussion of the shortcomings and failures of any given experiment, and it is okay, possibly even a good idea, to include a paragraph that records your own experiment's shortcomings and failures also. Another body paragraph you might include in your lab report will discuss future research implications for this kind of experiment. For example, what kind of experiment might come next? In the potato battery experiment, for example, you may have used different kinds of food to study the flow of electrons under different conditions. How else might this concept be studied? What might improve the experiment? What might need to be changed to do that future research meaningfully? This kind of experimental design thinking can demonstrate that you understood the point of the experiment. If you feel stumped here, you can look to the experimental design questions in your lab guide to get your thinking flowing. We've made it to the conclusion paragraph in your discussion section. This is usually just one paragraph. It should be a summary of the goals of the experiment and whether you reached those goals. This is your chance to really show your instructor that you understood and learned something from the lab. You might try a concrete sentence that goes something like this. This lab taught me X, or this lab demonstrated X. Then you want to prove it by making a connection to the experiment that is personal to you, to your life, to another class you are taking, to something that you thought about that might be original just to yourself. Finally, let's discuss the best way to boost your lab report. You can and probably should read through your report for typos and grammar issues more than once. But you should also get in the habit of doing a read-through that looks only at your word choice and tone, and that's what we'll focus on today. You will be amazed at how much simple changes in word choice can boost the professional tone of your lab reports. And the more effort you put into word-level choices, the easier it will become. Practice makes perfect. The best scientific writing strikes a balance between being concise, or brief, and being precise, meaning it includes the necessary specific descriptions, such as the numeric data collected during the experiment. Again, you don't want to say the ice melted slowly. That is not precise. Rather, you want to give the exact amount of time it took for the ice to melt. But you want to say it concisely, using as few words as possible. Let's pause here to discuss some chemistry professor pet peeves in lab reports. Here are some common chemistry lab problem phrases that you should read through your lab reports and try to avoid using. I've put it in a chart. Don't say the things that are on the left-hand column. Instead, try something similar to what's on the right-hand column. For example, you don't want to say, I weighted 10.6 grams of NaCl. Instead, you want to say, 10.6 grams of NaCl was weighed. Next, you don't want to say something like, I turned on the scale. That is an obvious step that is unnecessary, and it goes against the rule of being concise in your lab reports. Instead, you can say something like, the scale was zeroed before beginning the experiment. This shows that you're using your instruments correctly. This kind of detail is important for precision in your lab reports. Next, you don't want to tell your reader that you grabbed or gathered or collected chemicals. These kinds of details are both too colloquial, meaning too chatty, and they're also too repetitive. Instead, say nothing. This step of gathering your chemicals and your materials is listed in your equipment and materials section, and it doesn't need to be repeated. Next, you don't want to say, I did X, and then I did Y, and then I did Z, and then I did A. That sounds pretty repetitive. Just cut it out. You can take out the first and the then language, go straight to the point. Finally, you've heard this before. You don't want to say something like, it got very hot. The word very is an unnecessary and unhelpful description. Instead, you want to be specific and use chemical language to say what you need to say. You can try. The reaction was exothermic. This was shown when the temperature was measured initially at 25.0 degrees Celsius, and it increased to 93.0 degrees Celsius. Here is a non-comprehensive one-time read-through checklist that you might use when you are going through your lab report. Remember, you should always do a separate read-through at least once, just to make sure all of your sentences make sense and to catch grammar errors and typos before you do this more focused read-through for word choice editing. I'm going to read through the list, but you can also pause this and come back to it anytime you want. First of all, importantly, is everything your own work? Have you avoided plagiarism? Second, is your writing concise? Third, is it precise? Have you included units and significant figures for every measurement discussion? Have you deleted all adjectives and adverbs? Those are words that describe nouns or verbs. For example, very, often, really, slowly, also big, soft, hard, wet, things like that. Next, have you checked subject-verb agreement? For example, if you say all apples are sweet, your plural subject, apples, goes with a plural verb, are. Word processing programs will generally flag disagreeable subject-verb pairs. So for example, if your sentence said, all apples is sweet, that would be incorrect, and Word would put a little squiggly line under the verb, which is there. If you see that blue squiggly line, it usually means something is wrong, and you should look at it again to see what you can fix. Next, are there overly long or run-on sentences? Shorter sentences are almost always better, even if the sentence is grammatically correct. Often, a run-on sentence will have multiple verbs, which are the action words in your sentence. That's one way you can catch that and try to fix it. You can usually put a period somewhere in the middle of a long sentence and edit for brevity. Next, have you used the right version of every word? There are words that are called homonyms, which sound the same, but they're spelled differently and they have different meaning. Two examples of homonyms that students often trip up on are the there homonyms or the to homonyms. Make sure that you know which meaning each word carries and that you use the appropriate term. Finally, look through your graphs, tables, and images and make sure you have captioned all your photos, you have used graph paper or spreadsheet for all graphs, you have titled all tables and graphs, and you have labeled all table and graph components. One final tip. Many of the best writers in their fields take the time to read their almost final drafts out loud before calling the work finished. This out loud reading feels really awkward and often boring, but you will be amazed how often you'll find sentences that don't make sense or words that contain typos by using this editing technique. If it feels too awkward, you might try reading out loud to stuffed animals, read to a pet, or even read your work to an unfortunate roommate. Remember, you can always refer back to the checklist or any other slide that I've offered here if you feel stumped and need some help. Happy lab report writing!